money, and we are a very historical city, but we have also very modern facilities. And even though we are not necessarily known as well as Harvard or MIT, we have got a Nobel Prize for electrochemistry in Prague to one of our scientists about 50 years ago. And our university, at which I'm located, developed contact lenses about 40 years ago. It was the first place which developed contact lenses for it. And so then the contact lenses actually originated at our university. And our institute, just at our campus, has 80% of market of anti-HIV drug. So the patent, this patent is licensed to the United States, and this drug actually covers 80% of the market. So we are quite a research intensive place in Prague. And what we do, we will talk about nano micromotors, micro machines. If you are not from this field, you may at least remember the Nobel Prize in 2016 to those three gentlemen, which I was honored to meet two of them. And those gentlemen made or got Nobel Prize for design and synthesis of molecular machines. So the machines, the motors, which are size of molecules. I want to highlight, we don't work on such size. We work on one order of magnitude higher, bigger size, and so on. So I will show you where they work and where we work. So if I look at scale, so nanorobots, how big they are. So the Feringa and the Nobel Prize guys work on the 1 to 10 nanometer size. So basically size of molecules, really. While we work on the size of the viruses, about 50 nanometers to 10 micrometers. So it's from the size of the virus to size of the red blood cell, approximately. What is the advantage? We can actually use for many of our robots, we can use light microscope, normal microscope to actually follow, track those robots to see what they do. And also for the really small nanorobots, which are of the size 50 to 100 nanometers, we cannot directly see them under normal microscope, but we use a special scattered light type of microscope to follow those robots. What's similar to the Feringa and those people who got the Nobel Prize for molecular motors is that we design our robots also basically layer by layer by molecular layers. So we are very specific with layering and construction of the robots. And also, I will show you actually what the robots are. They are not of the shape of the robot you can imagine, but they are really more of the shape of the cells and small viruses. So what the actually micro nanorobot does? So the first kind of distinguishing the micro nanorobot from any nanoparticle, microparticle is the motion. It's autonomous motion. Of course, we all know that if we put some object and we put a magnet next to it, it will be attached. So we don't talk about like attaching, you know, moving something by magnet, but we talk about self-propelled autonomous motion. So our robots, micromotors, microrobots, nanorobots move in the first instance by themselves. This motion can be induced, and it's typically induced by decomposing chemical in the environment around the robot. So typically we put robot in the solution. There is some fuel. You can imagine it as something like bacteria moving, but it's not alive. So we put the object which we construct. For example, a very simple example, you can have a tube which has a platinum interior, gold exterior. So if there is platinum inside, you put hydrogen peroxide inside the tube, makes bubbles and moves. Okay, so this is one of the examples. You can also put inside of the tube, you can put enzyme, and this enzyme actually can decompose, for example, glucose, and you have a product, again, it moves, and so on. You can have different way of constructing, it doesn't have to be hollow, it can be spherical. In such case, we talk about Janus robots, Janus motors, But the key is you are decomposing the chemical in the environment and the robot moves. Now, if the robot moves, that's fine. But if the robot moves randomly and doesn't do anything, that's kind of like a waste of the energy, waste of the time. So typically when you imagine a robot, like big robot, it should do something, right? Otherwise, why do we have it? So our nano micro robots should do as well something. So we make some functional surfaces. Again, if I have the robot, this is my pen, it's the robot. So if I want a robot to do something, I can put some functional molecules on the surface. So I can put proteins, or I can put DNA, or I can put catalyst to decompose some chemical which is harmful to the environment. And so my robot is moving and, for example, collecting DNA in the solution, or if I have catalyst on the surface, decomposing harmful chemicals from the solution. Good. So it does something. Now it moves and it does something. Now, the point is it moves randomly, typically. Quite often it's not a problem because for cleaning of the environment, for environmental remediation, we can have enhanced diffusion of those robots through the environment. But for many applications, you'd like to have the autonomous but directed motion. So how do we direct the motion? In the nature, you know, you know that actually plants grow towards the sun. Yeah, so we call it phototaxis, special name, but it's basically following the sun or light. So we can actually construct the robots in the way they also are either photocatalytically activated, so they actually move only by the light irradiation, then they have water splitting, and they move towards the light source. Or you can have also chemotaxis. Again, chemotaxis is something very simple, is that you smell the food and you follow the food. Yeah, so you follow the gradient of the chemical. Or you can do magnetotaxis. Many animals perform magnetotaxis. They actually orient themselves according to the Earth magnetic field. We can construct robots which do the same. So this is the possible to do. We can actually construct robots which orient themselves according to magnetic field, or they follow the light. Now, the last and the kind of most important holy grail in this field is collective behavior. As one virus will not kill you, one bacteria will not do any harm to you if you eat any, you know, bacteria, or any bacteria doesn't do anything in macroscopic scale unless you have lots of bacteria. And it can do something, obviously, but it performs some action to have a real impact on the applications. And in many applications which I present today, you know, we talk about large swarms of the robots. Again, this is not a complete trivial issue to construct them so they move together in a coordinated manner. So I will just highlight the difference between the normal robots, the large robots, which create the swarms, and micro nano robots creating the swarms. So I just put a couple of pictures of mostly military swarms using drones or boats, which can communicate all of those swarms, or just research swarms on the top right corner. So those are small or large devices which navigate and communicate with each other to make kind of swarm and move together. But they communicate via radio signals, okay? And this is different from micro nanorobot because they are so small. We cannot put radio transmitter receiver to them. So we make them to communicate in similar manner as animals or bacteria. How do bacteria or animals create swarms? Well, those are the swarms of animals, birds, butterflies, bacteria, actually on the top right people. Yeah? So they communicate by either optical signals or, more important, chemical signals. So if they communicate by chemical signals, and this is also the way how we make the swarms to navigate by light or by chemical signals. Okay. And now I'd like to go more to the three topics I'd like to discuss today. First topic is medicine, but using nano and micro robots in biomedical sciences. After that, I will move to using nano and micro robots in environmental remediation, which means cleaning environment from pollutants. And the last part, it will be looking at micro nanorobots in the area of extraction of natural resources, which is somehow connected to environmental protection, because the whole idea is to improve the current processes. Otherwise, why should we do it, right? So why should we waste time? So we talk about first nanorobots in medicine, as well as your surgeon is the topic, yeah? So the inspiration of nano-micro machines it's not a completely new idea. The field is new. It's about 10 years old, actually almost precisely. It's rapidly growing. But the idea of actually small micro nanorobot moving in your body is old. And there was some famous movie in 1966 where, you know, a very rich man was kind of terminally ill, and he hired scientists to be shrunk to very small size with the submarine. And then the Hollywood movie goes on as the submarine moves in the body. And yeah, it's kind of interesting. Today it's kind of funny to see it because the effects are certainly not up to the standard of the year 2020. But the whole idea of having some small submarine in the body is not new. And this idea from 1966 actually also kind of hit the idea that actually this submarine will encounter lots of problems in the body. The body will try to fight with it. And of course, we see the same thing in these days if we use the motors or robots to move in the body. So why should we actually do such a task like putting a robot, micro nanorobot in a human body or animal body? There must be some advantage. And we can look at few advantages. Of course, not everything would become better if we do it, but we should focus on the area where actually micro nanorobots would improve. So what we do, why we do it? Because we can improve the treatment. So we should move to the areas where it's minimally invasive treatment without micro nano surgeries without much damage to the organism. Or we can do targeted drug delivery. So we can have a micro nanorobot carrying the drugs, and only when they sense the cell, they release the drug. So we have very localized, precisely localized the release of the drug based on the motion of the robot through the body. And again, if you have minimally invasive treatment, you don't need anesthetics. So again, the whole process can be done on people without putting them asleep. So I will show you two examples from other groups, and then I will go to example to our group, because I don't just want to do propaganda or promotion of our group, but I want to also promote others' works, which is really nice. Before doing that, I'd like to also mention actually what nanorobot means, because we always talk about robots, right? Nanorobots. And funnily enough, the word robot is, the word nano means dwarf, and name robot means which gave to the word is the Czech word. And actually it means hard work, typically on the field, but any really hard work. And it was used about actually exactly 100 years ago in a special theater play where he used the word robot in the meaning we use the word robot today. It's hard workers, you know, machines which do hard work. So this is just, you know, some culture insertion, because it's always good to know what the words mean, especially when we use them. So I always like to find the source of the words and their original meaning and current meaning. Anyway, let's go back to the surgeries. So one of the examples which I like to use is from my colleague from the United States, from Johns Hopkins Hospital. He's using kind of robotic grippers. They are not self-propert in this case, so they are just grippers. So they grip based on the pH changes or temperature changes, they do this. And why he uses this? So why I chose this example? Because he's already applying this to the pigs, you know, to the animal models, to large animals, not only to the rats, but to the pigs, which are quite large animal models. And what he's trying to do is, normally if you have some ulcer in the stomach, if you have some stomach problem, serious problem, then you often have sample of the tissue taken out of the stomach for analysis, whether you have cancer or what kind of problems you have. And what typically they use the pliers, the device you see in the middle of the slide, which is several millimeters big. What they do, they put it through your throat, take piece of the stomach, take it out. Well, then you have bleeding in the stomach because you have some small surgery, and it's basically by doing this, and then it's not good for your organism, but this is a standard procedure. So what he tries to improve this, to have minimally invasive treatment, is that we have those grippers which have magnetic layer. You can see that those grippers are of the size about 0.5 millimeters, 500 microns. So they are millimeter-sized robots, I would say, sub-millimeter. And they have this kind of shape of the hand or star. And when those joints are made of polymer, those fingers are made of metal, and when you swallow them, and then there is a pH change or temperature change the wall of your stomach, they do this. And means that there is some inflammation or some ulcer, and they do this, and they take piece of the bit cells inside of the gripper, and then it's from ETH Zurich, from our colleagues Salvador Panevidal and Professor Nelson. What they do surgery of the micro robots in the eye of the rabbit. So they have the screw-like shape of the robot. As you can see, the robot has a size of several tens of micrometers in the middle. And then by turning the magnetic field, so it's a rotating magnetic field generated by coils, by turning the magnetic field, the robot moves. And this micro robot moves and makes micro nano surgery in the eye. And again, why this is better than normal surgery? Because the robot is much smaller, doesn't cause much damage to the eye, much less than, for example, syringe or the real surgery, which is done in the eye. So we have less invasive treatment. Another step what we can do with the robots, micro nanorobots, is actually use them for the drug delivery. So this is what we have done recently. We use the motors, micro machines, to actually load them with the drugs and carry the drug. Doxorubicin is anti-cancer drug, to the cancer cells where this is released. And we did it actually again in large quantities. So we had swarms of those robots, because one robot could do this, but there is not enough drug to cure the cancer in such case. So we have also another mechanism of releasing the drug. So we look at different mechanisms of releasing the drug. And one of the mechanisms of releasing of the drug is we have a motor, and up to the electrochemical impulse, we can release the drug. So when we want, this drug is released only when we say it should be released, you know, by electrochemical impulse. So we are working very hard in this field, looking at different size of the robots, different ways to carry the drug to the cell, and eventually even to do micro nano surgeries of the cells themselves. So we will talk about it a little bit later. So what are the future challenges of the motors or robots in the body? So the future challenges in general are the main, so far what we did is just the digestive tract. People did eye surgeries. But the biggest challenge is to actually have the robots in the bloodstream. Why is it a big challenge? Because you can imagine that in the digestive system, you can get the robots easily in and out. In the bloodstream, well, you can get them somehow in by syringe or by diffusion through the skin membrane. But to get them out of bloodstream, it's basically impossible. So they need to disintegrate themselves. They should not block your veins and so on. So basically, robots in the bloodstream, even this is typically the science fiction movie main focus, is the most difficult and most challenging, and I would say the most far away application, but it's not impossible. Yeah. So there are lots of groups working towards this direction, towards this dream. Yet another kind of huge challenge is to have the robots ready, you know, to be incorporated in the body. So what we are working on is, for example, wearable electronics, smart patch, which can detect if you are sick and with what, and releases the robots inside your body. So basically, again, it can be the skin, or typically where this is released, and the robots can then penetrate deeper and cure the disease. We are looking at also and big challenge is the mouth. So actually we are looking at the surgeries of the mouth and the tooth and so on. So we have actually very nice works in this direction as well. So I will move from the biomedical, even it's very popular, to also extremely important area, which is the environmental remediation. It means environmental cleaning or the cleanup. So I chose several examples from our, I wouldn't say competitors, so from other groups. What kind of environmental problems you can address with micro nanorobots? And again, what's the advantage of the micro nanorobots? Typically, if you have some oil spill or chemical spill or dangerous chemical, what you do in large amounts, you just spray some other chemical to neutralize it, to decompose our harmful compound. But how you do it? You just spray it or pound it over, but you don't, it's very difficult to mix it. And to, so the idea is to mix it to enhance the decomposition. Oil decomposition by micro machines, micro robots, decomposition of contaminants like pesticides, and so on. So this is very, very important. Also, some of the actually motors, robots can be even powered by the pollutant, which means that actually when there is a pollutant, they move faster. When there is less pollutant, they move slower. There is no pollutant, they stop moving. So there is very, very innovative approach from Dresden, for example. So this is, of course, not all pollutants can power the motors, yeah, obviously. So those are the groups. And what we focus on a lot is mass fabrication of those robots. Because if you want to do, I mean, for biomedical purposes, it's important, but still you don't need so many of them as for environmental remediation. For really cleaning environment, you need kilograms or even tons quantities, typically tons quantities, really large amounts. And to make the robots, which are really tiny, in clean room in tons amounts is almost impossible. I'm not saying it's impossible because nothing is impossible. Everything is possible. It's quite expensive if you want to do it in clean room. So what we decided to do, especially for the environmental cleaner, is to use some templates to do some hybrid like cyborgs, yeah, half natural, half artificial organisms. So what we decided to take with our collaborator actually from NTU Singapore, pollen particles from sunflower, because you can have lots of sunflower. You can have really kilograms of sunflower pollen. So those are the small pollen particles, which actually I'm allergic to typically when I go outside in the fields. If you look at the sunflower pollen particles, they are micron, tens of micron size particles of the particle shape. As you can see, the shape is depending on the type of the plant you work with. And those particles are having spikes. You can actually, what I like about them is apart of having top, you know, kilograms and more of those particles, you can, they are from basically, you cannot destroy them in normal environment. Of course, if you burn them, you burn them, but they are really extremely stable. They can survive, you know, eons. We have a pollen particles from time of dinosaurs. So actually, they can survive millions of years. They're very, very robust. They have interior. You can actually put something inside of the pollen. And also you can absorb things on the exterior on the outside of the pollen. So what we did is we did two things. We demonstrated the pollen capability by covering part of the pollen with motor part, which actually starts actually propelling the pollen inside. So we make the self-propelled pollen, so actually self-moving pollen particle. So it's our hybrid. We have to collect the heavy metals because of the interactions with amino acids. So I will show you the motion. So this is just how the pollen looks like under microscope, optical or electron microscope, how it moves when it's modified with platinum layer on one side. So it decomposes the fuel, the hydrogen peroxide, and makes bubbles, as you can see in the bottom. And the bubbles actually make it move. I will show you on the video much better. Show you like that. So this is our pollen particle. If you haven't seen the moving pollen, so you see the moving pollen now. And you see the bubbles coming out of it. Now, since I talk about heavy metal cleanup, I will not talk about this drug delivery application. I'd like to talk about heavy metal cleaning. And this heavy metal cleanup is done by those robots in large quantities. And you can see the red line on the graph up and the black line. So the red line is the motor, the robots, exactly as it is, the hybrid platinum on pollen particle without fuel, no hydrogen peroxide. And you are looking at the decrease of lead concentration. The decrease is very slow. If you make them moving, so they move this scrap whole solution, the decrease of the lead concentration, so the adsorption on the surface of the moving pollen is much faster. So again, the motion is the key. Okay, so the black line is for the moving pollen particles robots, and the red line is for the stationary one, which moved by diffusion. So of course there is some removal, but very slow. So we also move to another direction, looking at biocompatible compounds which can be actually released to the environment easily. And we work with our collaborators in another Czech company. They have a big company which create iron zero with very thin iron oxide shell. So what is the iron zero so special? If you have iron bar, so the piece of iron, I have a spoon here. So the spoon is from iron, and of course it's just piece of metal. But if you have nanoparticle from iron and you expose it to the air, it burns. So it oxidizes, as you can see in the middle. If you just pour it from nitrogen atmosphere to normal air, it's so small that it oxidizes, and the oxidation is, of course, it generates heat. And since it's really small, we have lots of surface, it generates lots of heat, and it looks like burning. Yeah. So to prevent this, you coat the iron zero with very thin shell of iron oxide, which basically stabilizes the particle, and you can have it as particle of iron zero in the solution. And I knew that my colleagues are selling this in tons quantities, really large quantities, for real environmental applications around the world. So I said, okay, how do you use it? Well, if there is some spill under the ground, some chromium, compounds or some organic pollutants, what they do, they drill to the earth and they put this iron zero particles there and wait. What do they do? They diffuse slowly inside the ground, and the problem of actually cleaning the underground is big. There's a big problem because you cannot mix it. You basically drill fluid and either you push the pressure, so actually things go and kind of slowly by flow disperse, or you just inject and wait for diffusion and fluxes underground to mix everything there. And this is, of course, time consuming very much. So I told my colleagues, okay, if we make those iron zero moving, iron zero particles moving, we have basically micro robots, because they will be moving much faster and decomposing the chemicals underground much faster because they diffuse much faster. And indeed we did, and by putting actually those micro, actually they are nanoparticles, but quite often they create clusters, so micro nanoparticles of iron zero, in slightly acidic solution, they start dissolving and moving really fast, and they degrade the pollutants much faster than they would do with stationary particles. So I'm very proud of this project, because it's actually can use the iron zero particles, which are produced in tons quantities. Yet another direction we chose is again take environmentally friendly advanced materials, which are actually clays. Clay is something you make the pot or coffee cup from. So in China, there's lots of culture of making beautiful clay pots and everything. So we have special clays around the world which are made from halloysite. Halloysite is specially clay which create nanotubes naturally. They are not carbon nanotubes, they are nanoclay tubes which have either interior, exterior, and they are used widely for decades to trap pollutants, especially heavy metals, because of oxygen containing groups on the nanoclays. So what we did is again we modified them inside with catalysts so they actually can move themselves as robots, and they use their natural capability to catch the heavy metals from the environment, and we collect them later. Again, the advantage is we can make them in really large quantities in the tons, and just mine them in the nature. So we can have really large quantities of those nanorobots. And they are nanorobots because, as you can see from the size of the bar, the length is 50 nanometers, but diameter is about 100 nanometers. So they are quite small. So I will want to move on from this catching the heavy metals by kind of, we'll say, non-specific interactions, because all the previous interactions were all the same for all heavy metals. So you could scrap all heavy metals from the environment, which is good. I would like to also go to more specific and targeted heavy metal removal. And here, this is just to show you that we can actually remove heavy metals specifically, only separate heavy metals, for example, mercury 2+, by moving motors with specific DNA sequence on the surface. So this is the functional surface with a single-stranded DNA strand, which is selective to mercury. So as it moves, it catches the mercury ions, and then you can remove it later from the solution, for example, by filtration or by magnetic interactions after they scrap the solution in similar manner as the pollen particles. So this is regarding the cleaning the environment, and I will have the last slide on the environmental cleanup, which is very recent work which we did. It's now online in Advanced Functional Materials. It doesn't have page numbers yet. Is the microplastic removal. So as you may have heard, the microplastic is the really big problem for environment in general, and especially for the water bodies like lakes and sea, because we all use the plastic, and even if we want to recycle some of it, goes to this huge problem for which actually decomposing, they are based on a bismuth tungstenate, and they are photocatalytic. So when we shine the light, for example, from the sun, they're powered by sun in the water. So they move, and then they can swarm and attach to the textile fibers, polymer textile, like cleaning wipes. And because of the water splitting reaction, they actually can decompose slowly, but still much faster than the nature itself, the fibers and the polymer. Yeah. So by interacting with it and basically creating oxygen radicals. Okay. So those are motors for microplastic removal. And after that, I want to show you concept what we developed relatively recently for really clean up or large bodies of water, because what we typically do is we have small micro nanorobots, and those small micro nanorobots, they move fine, they move even several millimeters per second, but still to cross large space, it takes some time for them. So what we kind of develop is mothership concept. So we have a large robot several millimeters large, which we load with the nano micro robots, and then we will put it in the in the water. And actually, this large robot moves much faster. It can move distances tens of meters and disperse the nano robots or micro robots over the way. So, for example, in this left side, we have millimeter size robot which moves tens of meters, and it's loaded with micro robots which are light powered, and they decompose nitro aromatic compounds. So as it moves, it disperses all the time those robots which are in turn powered by sun, and they move and they decompose the nitro aromatic compounds. On the right side of the slide, I have the same concept but one level smaller. So I have micro robot mothership carrier which is carrying the nanorobots. Those nanorobots are loaded with the drugs, so this is for biomedical application. Okay, but it's just to show you this concept, and of course we want to take it one level up. So we are now discussing incorporating large drones to carry it several kilometers and to disperse in the environment and have environmental cleanup. So it will be robot within the robot within the robot. Okay, so it's just like three levels of robotic systems together, carrying each other. And basically, this is the presentation is going to the end because I have only a few minutes left, and I have only two slides left. So I'd like to talk about extraction of natural resources. This is new direction of what we do, and again, we should improve the current technologies which are used for extraction. And as you can imagine, we are mining as humankind. We are mining, for centuries and thousands of years. The copper and iron and gold, and also in modern age, we are mining nickel, cobalt, uranium, lithium, and so on. And the point is that the technologies are really, I would say, old. I mean, they are mass productive. They are very harmful to the environment. The point is to make it more efficient. Yeah, so we have less harm to the environment. And what we developed is actually micro robots, which are moving through layer of uranium in the ground. How you typically mine the uranium or clean the environment? You put sulfuric acid, you dissolve what is there, and you pump it back. So this is very harmful. We have this in my country, so it's lots of mines, uranium mines on different ways. It's the surface mines and deep mines, which actually you are pushing the liquid, the sulfuric acid, and trying to extract the uranium. And one of the ways is to enhance this extraction from the ground is to use robots which move and again sweep the environment and absorb the uranium on the surface, and then we collect them and take them out and release the uranium. And the same if it's lithium. So again, lithium is quite harmful to the environment, and this extraction again takes lots of space and lots of resources. So again, we try to make the robots which are specific to extract lithium only and concentrate it and process it. So I have one video here which actually was prepared by ACS Nano, so I will try to play it if it plays. And the point is that actually source of energy, so hopefully it will play. So this is just a part of the video. You can watch it later. So you can just look at this publication, Google Uranium and my name and video, and you will see it. Hall, the point is you can clean the wastewater, or you can actually clean, and we have small pilot project running now. You can kind of extract it also from the environment for processing. So this is a very new topic in this field, and in the field of micro nanorobots, and we are actually putting lots of resources into it because we see it as a very promising direction of the research to extract the natural resources. And with kind of this, I'd like to end. I'd like to end. I'd like to close the talk with our covers of micro nanorobots. So those are our covers from last few years with different applications of micro or nanorobots. You can visit our website of nanorobots.cz, and or you can follow us on Twitter if you have access to Twitter, obviously, at the Pumera Group. And I'd like to thank you for your attention. And it's exactly 45 minutes gone. So I'd like to pass the word back to the organizers. And I think the talk will be open for discussion. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Prof. Martin. So now we're going to start the Q&A section. Before we start, so during the our staff is collecting the questions, I just briefly introduce SmartMath. SmartMath is a newly launched open access journal by Tianjin University and Wiley. So editors-in-chief are Professor Wenping Gu from Tianjin University and Professor Hua Zhang from City University of Hong Kong. The scope of SmartMath is quite broad. Topics include but not limited to organic and polymeric functional materials, shape memory alloys, and biomimetic robotics, smart textiles, electro-rheological and magneto-rheological fluid, AI, and neuromorphic devices and systems, metamorphic biomaterials, self-healing materials, piezoelectric materials, and artificial muscles. So now we are open for submission. Welcome to publish your work in SmartMath. Now we're going to start the Q&A section. I will ask some questions on behalf of the audience. The questions are collected from the live broadcasting platforms of like Bilibili, Baidu Live, and YouTube. So the first question is, how to guide the movement or to monitor the movement of nanorobots when doing drug delivery?
Yes, so this is again the most challenging part, because so the drug direction and tracking. So you can have either, it's really depending on the application. So we can have, so let's put it this way. If I want to do, for example, we have some dental surgery or actually cleaning the tooth channels project now. Obviously the robots themselves are constructed completely different from different materials and with different aim than the, for example, cancer drug delivery. And again, the drug delivery can be done on skin, because you have also problems with biofilms growing on the body, like Staphylococcus or Streptococcus. So they are from outside of the body, growing somewhere, can be inside, but easily accessible. Or it's something really inside of the body, and that's more challenging. So there are two questions in one question. So one to guide and how to monitor. So the guiding can be done again by magnetic field. Again, weak magnetic field. It's not the field to proper, but it's field to guide. If you like to have another guidance system, you can have it actually not guided, but you can have it randomly moving, but only releasing the drug only when it comes in contact with cancer cell and you get biorecognition. So there is another approach to it. The monitoring is again much more challenging when it's deep in the body. So if it's on, obviously, for example, we have very close collaboration with the dental community. So if it's inside of your mouth in your teeth, it's relatively easy to follow up, because it's translucent to the light and it's relatively easy to follow up. If it's deep in your body, actually, now we have different techniques, for example, to track the magnetic particles. But of course, you have to make the robot with some small magnetic part to be able to track it. So this kind of diagnostics and following the robot inside of the body is the most challenging, actually. And people are rapidly developing this field. But there are different methods. As I said, any application of the robots inside of the body is the most challenging. So indeed, it's a very good question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And the second question is to remove the microplastics by nanorobots, how to make it more effective, or what is the challenge now to use this method broadly?
Yes, so that's a very good question. The microplastic itself is a huge problem, because the microplastic is actually what remains after the plastic degrades. So if we have, if it was easy to degrade, it would be already gone. So what was easy to degrade is gone, and what is really difficult to degrade is remaining in the seas. And now another problem is that the microplastic is very broad term, as like we would say animals. Okay, we have animals, there are small animals, big animals, birds, you know, mammals, fish. So the same is microplastic. Microplastic is plastic polymers, but they are made of very different polymers. And those very different polymers have different chains and different groups. You can decide. So what we do now, and it's a really young field for the robots, we need to standardize, right? So you have lots of different types of polymers, and you cannot save everything in once, at least now. So we decide, okay, this polymer we can attack, we can cut it to smaller parts, oligomers, by this reaction. So we construct the robot which is able to attack and destroy this polymer, but not other polymers, because they are just completely different type of polymer. So currently the biggest challenge is actually that you have so big variety of the polymers to be attacked that currently you have to go one by one. It's like this biomedical research. You need to construct a robot specific to this reaction. I'm sure in longer run, you can be more creative, putting two active groups and so on. But currently, like, destroying the polymers is really very specific. And that's so far the current state of art. What we are also doing is actually, and it was second part of your question, to collect. So we are actually, I don't want to comment more because it's not published, and we are just submitting in a few days, are the robots which are actually able to kind of collect the plastic and remove. So they don't try to destroy it, but they are going and basically collect and then make themselves actually very big, because they are moving and collecting the plastic. And of course, in the end, we have to collect them with the plastic out of the solution, because they cannot do it themselves. But this is also the way basically to sweep the sea for a micro nanoplastic and collect it. And then when it's kind of larger particles, then we can remove them. So this is, again, this field is about 2 years old. Yeah, this is a really young field, but I see lots of potential, because this is a really huge problem for humanity, yeah? The microplastic in the seas.
Thank you so much. So the last question is about the enrollment. So is there any specific requirement for the students or postdoc that would like to apply position in your group, or like is there any like specific scholarship that we can apply?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so this is really a very specific question. So thank you very much for asking that. So I have some call to make off. So yes, that is actually the requirement. Yeah, there is fellowship we actually offer automatically. So if you get to our group, you get funded by our group, by our institute. So there is fully funded fellowship, no need to pay anything, and you get quite good fellowship to live on. I mean, you will not become Elon Musk within 3 years and millionaire, but you will have a comfortable life to comfortably work in our lab. And requirements, what I'm looking is the energy. So people should have energy to want to do something in life. But if they ask this question, I guess they have. So they should have the drive. So they would like, I'm looking for the people with energy and with love and passion what they do. You know, and this field is really multidisciplinary. So I have people from actually mathematics and physics, really pure calculations. And I have people through chemistry doing actually experiments with the animals. Yeah. So we have actually, you know, we can take anybody who has energy and they are keen to do and work and enjoy what they do. Yeah. Don't take it for the just career. just my advice to the students, you know, you should find or think what you would like to do and just immerse yourself and do it for 4 years and you will succeed in any direction, whether nanorobots or solar cells. But if you like to join us, yeah, we will be very happy. So that's all. And there is no limit. We interview you and we have a very, very international team. We have people from China, Spain, Italy. Actually, even I'm in Czech Republic. I have only two people, now three. Okay, it was used to be me and my secretary and everybody else is foreigner. And now we have one Czech student. So that's still very international out of 20 or now 50 people. Yeah, so that's all. So thank you very much for asking and please drop me email. We talk and if you like us and we like you, we take you.
Thank you so much, sir. So please let's thank Prof. Martin for the wonderful talk again and welcome to submit your excellent work to SmartMath. It will be our pleasure to publish your work in the journal. Thank you so much and see you next time. 感谢科研云和能源学人的支持，近期会有更多精彩讲座，敬请持续关注 SmartMath。今天的直播到此结束，感谢您的支持。
Okay, Martin, thank you for your great talk.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Take care.
It was my pleasure and see you in China.